So we are going to see the differential band break, and the difference between the differential band break and the simple band break is about the position of the fulcrum, O. Now if you see over here in the previous one, one end of the band is attached to the fulcrum, but here the no end of the band is attached to the fulcrum. Again the construction is a very same. Only the difference is about the position of the fulcrum. That is, construction is that it consists of a flexible band of leather, one or more ropes or steel lined with a frictional material. Again we are having a band break, and on this band we are having a brake drum, and on this brake drum a band is wrapped. Okay, partially wrapped we can say. One end of this band is connected at point A, while another is connected at point B. The fulcrum is actually at point at O, and point A is at a distance small a from O, and point B is at a distance small b from B. So no end of the band is connected to the fulcrum, but it is at some distance, and that's why it is called as a differential band break. While breaking force P is applied at a distance C, at a point C, which is at a distance L from the fulcrum O. Now this is how the construction is, how it works. Again, same working is very same. Whenever we will apply a downward force at point C, because of that the band will be tightened on the brake drum, and then there will be the friction between the band and the brake drum, and the brake is being applied. So again the friction between the band and the brake drum is responsible for applying the brakes over here. Now we will see how to find the braking force in the differential band brake. Again we will take a moment, we will take moment about fulcrum O, that is about O. Okay, we are considering the equilibrium condition, and we are taking the moment about O. Now again here there are the two conditions. One is that when the brake drum is rotating in the clockwise direction, and another is that when the brake drum is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. So when the brake drum rotates in the clockwise direction, when brake drum rotates in the clockwise direction, we can see the end of the band which is connected at B is it become tight side, while the end of the band which is connected at A becomes a slack side. While when the brake drum is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction, and in that case the end of the band which is connected at A becomes a tight side, and the end of the band which is connected at B becomes a slack side. Now we will solve this, and taking moment about O. So if I take the moment about O, then I can write down P into L, that is force P into the distance of P from O, plus T1 into B as the moment. Because of the tight side, T1 is going to assist moment by the P, and that's why we are adding it. T1 into B is equal to T2 into A, right? So I can say P into L is equal to T2 A minus T1 B. This is for when clockwise rotation of drum. Clockwise rotation. And if I consider the anti-clockwise rotation, then taking the moments, I can say P into L plus T2 into B is equal to T1 into A. Now if you look over here, we can say the T2 is assisting the movement because of the slack side T2, or the tension T2 is assisting the force movement because of force P, and that's why we added this. And we can write down P into L is equal to T1A minus T2B. So this condition for the anti-clockwise rotation of the drum, right? So these are the two conditions which we derived, and these two conditions, from these two conditions we can find out the braking force. Now if we look at this, when we say that when the frictional force assists the, when this frictional force assists the braking force, then we call this type of brakes as a self-energizing brake. Self-energizing brakes. And in this condition, what we are seeing, when it is rotating in the clockwise direction, then the tight side T1 is assisting. This tight side T1 is assisting the braking force, or the movement because of the braking force, and that's why we can say it is a self-energizing. While over here in anti-clockwise rotation, this braking force is being assisted by the slack tension T2, and that's why we can say this is again a self-energizing brake. Okay, but when we say when this P is negative, P is negative, that is there is no need of external force to be applied for achieving the braking action, this type of brakes we call as a self-locking brake. Now when this brakes will be self-locking, this when this P will be negative. And when this P can be negative, I can say when this T2A is less than equal to T1B for clockwise rotation. For clockwise rotation, jab ye T2A T1B se kam rahega, at that time this PL will be negative, and then we can say it is a self-locking brake. So I can write down, this is for the clockwise rotation obviously, and I can write down T2 by T1 is less than equal to B by A. Similar, this is for clockwise. Similarly, for anti-clockwise, I can say when T1A is less than equal to T2B, then that brake can be called as a self-locking brake. That is T1 divided by T2 is less than equal to B by A. So this is condition for the anti-clockwise rotation of the drum. So this is what the differential band brake is, and differential band brake can be a self-energizing or it can be a self-locking brake when this distance B is greater than distance A. In that case, the force P should be applied in the upward direction. This force P should be applied in the upward direction to apply the brakes. That is the condition which we must remember.